special or a song you'd like to sing tonight, let me know. Okay?
Blessed by that message, Brother Randy. Man, I felt that. I felt that was a heartfelt message. I appreciate it. 255, page 255. Good encouragement.
Thank you. Jack said Amazing Grace. He's looking for the page. Can y'all find the page?
Okay. We'll do Amazing Grace next.
Tears in the eye.
another speaker to come, and I'm going to ask my son Gerald to come up tonight. And be able to take us into our break time. Amen.
I was hoping you'd say it's time to eat. You know, Randy slobbered in the mouth for some of that cornbread. Tell you what, I appreciate that message so much, brother. What an encouraging message. What a powerful testimony what the Lord's done in your life, the life of your family. God's good to us, isn't he? I also grew up in a preacher's home, but my life was very different from yours, brother. I'm the example of what God has to do to rescue a person. I have been on the bottom and experienced things that probably nobody should even try. And when God found me, he had to reach pretty low to pick me up. And I praise him for that. For his mercy, because I know it would have been much easier just to let me go, just to cut me loose. And he did. He didn't. He raised me up out of the dung heap, a refuse pile. And tonight is a marker for me, brother. Back in 2017, on this night, I surrendered my life, or it was actually in the morning, it was a Sunday morning. I surrendered my life to do whatever it is God wanted me to do. And so it's a privilege to get to preach tonight, and so I just want to, if you have your Bibles, let's turn to Mark chapter 13. Mark chapter 13, begin reading verse 32. But of that day and that hour, no man, not the angels which are in heaven, neither the Son, but the Father. Take ye heed, watch and pray, for ye know not when the time is. For the Son of Man is as a man taking a far journey, who left his house and gave authority to his servants and to every man his work, and commanded the porter to watch. Watch ye therefore, for ye know not when the master of the house cometh, at even, at midnight, or at the cock crowing, or in the morning, lest coming suddenly he find you sleeping. And what I say unto you, I say unto all, watch. I have a lot of friends who every year they look for the Lord to give them a word that they can remember during the year, a word from him. And if you're one of those people, I hope this message will stick with you, because I'd like to give you a word for the year. And the word is watch. It's not my word. It's a word that Jesus told his followers, his disciples, almost probably more, right at 2,000 years, maybe earlier, maybe a little later, we don't know exactly, but right around 2,000 years ago, the Lord said, I say this to all, watch. Heavenly Father, we give thanks for the opening and the reading of the word. I just give thanks for what our ears have heard so far. What an encouragement, Lord. What a blessing to know that through our lives, if we stay committed and continue in thee, the presence of the Lord, like the cloud and the fire, stays with us and guides us along our journey. And we're so grateful for that, Lord, because it just brings an overwhelming peace to our soul to know that our lives are guided and controlled by one who loves us eternally. And we just worship and give thanks for that. We give thanks for the privilege to be in the house of the Lord this night and to see out the old new year and to see in the new year where we have a new opportunity, Lord, to just serve, to serve thee and to serve the churches that we're involved in, Lord, and Lord, to hopefully be a blessing to thee by being a blessing to others. Be with us tonight as we go through this word. Give thanks for this group that's here tonight. Bless us tonight. Open our eyes and our ears in Jesus' name. I love to remember times when I was growing up, like Brother Randy was talking about being at Tuskegee
I can remember, we started going to Little Coweta in 1972. Dad preached his first message there in September of 72, and then he became pastor in February of 73. Well, in 72, I was 8 years old, and I don't think we did a watch night that year, but the next year when I was 9. And you got to understand, 9-year-olds back in 1973 are not anything like 9-year-olds today. Nothing. There's no such thing as an iPad, no such thing as a smartphone. And really, all I knew how to collect as far as data and information, if I can use those terms, was just doing a little ear hustling on what the adults were talking about. And when they started talking about having a watch night service, here's what I thought. Maybe the old people know that there's a chance that the Lord could come back at the end of this year, and as we get ready to go into the new year, and the watch night was watching for him. And I was scared. Just like I think the children of Israel were probably scared when that cloud was moving around and would move them, and they'd see that fire or the great Shekinah glory of God would come down and dwell on the temple. I'm sure it scared them. I mean, I think there's a good thing about having a healthy fear of the Lord. I think the problem with our world is nobody fears the Lord. Nobody's scared of him. Well, they're going to be scared one day, I promise you. I was scared because we met that night, and as it eased closer to 12 o'clock, I kept watching that back door because I just knew there was a good chance. If the old people were doing this, a watch night, I could only think that watching meant that the Lord could come walking through the door at any time. And I was scared. It scared me. I remember even after it was over, we were driving home and I was in the back of our little 1968 Chevy station wagon. I was laying in the back. I was watching out the window wondering, is it going to happen any second? What's going to happen? And I think the word watch is a very important word. I think as Christians, we need to be watching. The scripture tells us that we need to watch and to pray, and especially in this passage. And unless you're just a little brain dead, maybe, because I can be brain dead sometimes. But unless you're just totally brain dead, you've got to know that the coming of the Lord is very soon. You just got to know. You just got to feel it. People are just funky right now. It's hard to know what people are going to do next. It just is. Our world is crazy. We've got crazy people in the White House trying to run this country, and I don't think they have a clue. Or maybe they do know what they're doing, and maybe they're trying to run us off a cliff. I don't know. It's just crazy times. And I think it's very important for us as Christians to listen to the words of the Lord in this chapter. It's very important for us to watch and pray this next year. And I think the word of the Lord, maybe for us as Christians, is just watch. Now, that doesn't mean we just sit down somewhere and look at the sky. We have other duties and responsibilities to do. I think up until the time that the Lord takes the church away, we need to be about the business of seeing if we can win a few more souls, get a few more souls into the ark. Before it sails away. Because let me tell you something. When the Lord comes back and the ark leaves, the likelihood, I'm not going to say it's not possible for people to be saved in tribulation, but I'm just saying the likelihood for people to get saved during that period is going to be pretty slim. If people won't give their heart to the Lord right now, when they're free to do so, why on earth makes us think that they might do this whenever the chips are really down? I just don't know that that's going to happen. And I think that whenever the Lord comes back, I remember sitting I was outside and I was sitting on a rock and I was actually watching the sunset. It was a beautiful sunset. And I just remember this little trail of clouds following the sun as it was headed toward the horizon. And as it slipped over the horizon and disappeared, I thought, you know what? That's a picture of the church leaving. The glory of the Lord that hovers over this church building, when that church is called away, it's going to be like this great big light that leaves, and the light of God and His Word is going to be gone forever until He comes back and reigns here for 1,000 years. But the picture of the church will be gone.
And whenever it's gone, it's too late. We can't get any more people in. And I think we have to be about the business of doing what God called us to do during this time. But I think while we're working, we need to be watching. And we need to be praying. So I think it's significant in verse 32 where it says, "But of that day and that hour knoweth no man, no, not the angels which are in heaven, neither the Son, but the Father." And if you're hung up on the word being just watch, I think sometimes if you could just give a little leeway here, watch and pray can be the word for the year. That we need to watch and to take heed, watch and pray, it says in 33, "For ye know not when the time is." It tells us there in 34, it says, "For the Son of Man is as a man taking a far journey, who left his house, gave authority to his servants and to every man his work, and commanded the porter to watch." See, I believe we're the porter. The porter's the guy that watches the door. You say, so what door are we watching? What is that about? Well, you know, we are the temple. There's not a temple here with curtains that the Spirit of the Lord hovers over that we can watch like the children of Israel watched. Dad alluded to this in his message this morning out of 1 Corinthians. We are the temple. We've been bought with a price. We are the temple of God. We are the porter. What does that mean? Well, that means we need to watch at the gates of our eyes and our ears, and we need to control what comes in to our temple. We're the porter. We're the one that decides what's going to come into the, and we need to watch. We need to watch at this gate. I look at each one of you, and I know this is the temple that God built for you. But that's not, I can't see you. The real you that's on the inside is something completely different. I will know who you are when the Lord comes and gets us and he changes our vile body into something that's glorified. Then I will see who you really are. But we're living in these temples, and the Lord left us a command as porters of the temple. And he said that we are to watch and pray because we don't know when the Lord's coming. So what are we watching for? We're watching for his return. We're looking for it. You know, I work in a public place where I'm around people all the time, and it's funny, the people that come in, people around here are talking about that. They're talking about, this is a crazy world we live in, and God's coming back soon, the Lord's coming back soon. You hear people talking about it. And if you really want to minister to somebody, just bring that subject up. Because it draws people's attention over to where you're at. People want to know. People want to hear. Whenever you say, you know, I think the Lord's getting ready to come back. You'll draw a crowd if you start talking. You say, I don't know how to witness to somebody. I don't know how to talk to somebody. Just start talking about the Lord coming back. Talk about how we ain't got much time left. Folks will just pull right up. They'll pull right up and they'll start trying to gas up right there at your pump. They'll be trying to find out what's going on. They'll be trying to share what they know. You want to talk? You want to try and reach someone for the Lord? Just start talking about the Lord's coming. Be talking about, hey, I used to see these signs, and I just think that the times are here. And you start talking about it, and folks will pull right up, and they want to hear what you got to say. They want to know what you know. The Scripture tells us right here. He says that we are the porters, we are the doorkeepers, and so there's a blessing that comes from watching. A blessing. Turn with me to Proverbs chapter 8. Proverbs chapter 8. And look at verse 33 and 34 with me. "Hear instruction and be wise and refuse it not. Blessed is the man that heareth me," look at this, "watching daily at my gates, waiting at the posts of my door." See, your temple has gates and your temple has posts. And the Scripture tells us that there is a blessing that comes from watching at the Lord's temple. Are you watching? Are you looking for the Lord to come? Are you waiting for him? Are you ready to tell? Are you ready to open up the temple first thing in the morning and be talking about, I think the Lord's going to be coming back, start drawing folks to the temple? You know, we can be the crier. We can be the person that comes to the temple of the Lord and start talking about what the Lord's doing, and people will come to the door of the temple. They want to hear what you have to say. The scripture tells us we have to watch and pray. And he said, blessed is the man that heareth me watching daily at my gates. There's a blessing that comes from watching daily at the gates and waiting at the posts of the door. David said in Psalm chapter 84, verse 10, I'd rather be a doorkeeper in the house of my God than to dwell in the tents of the wicked. He said it to the porters, watch and pray. We're the porters. Are you content being just a doorkeeper at the house of the Lord? You know, we can tell that if we live in some really sketchy times, because I can remember whenever I was young. Matter of fact, I remember the first Watchnight service we had here in this church. We didn't even have the pews in here at that time. Remember that? The place was packed. This place was packed. I remember those Watchnight services at Little Coweta when I was a little kid. The place was packed. The pews were packed. People were there to watch for the new year to come in. And to be, so that the first task for the new year would be to pray it in and commit it to the Lord. The porters would all come to the temple of God and they'd assemble and pray. We don't have that kind of a crowd tonight. We just don't. We live in a very different time. The Lord commands us. And if you have a watch, or somebody says you got a watch on, you know what time it is. I want to put one of those little hypnotic suggestions in here, that when somebody says something about are you watching or you got a watch on, that you'll remember to pray. Watch and pray. Now this year, when you're going along, somebody's going to say that word to you. They're going to say that, Susan. They're going to say you got a watch. Or are you watching the football game? When somebody says, watch, you watching them schooners go up and down the field? When they say, watch, what should you think about praying? Come on. Because we're commanded in the scriptures, watch and pray. Watch and pray. When you hear that word this year, and somebody says, watch, you're going to watch them Chiefs play on Sunday. Watch. We need to think about praying. We need to be about our Father's business. There's a blessing if we'll watch and pray. Also, there's a responsibility that comes with watching. Verse 35, watch ye therefore, for you know not when the master of the house cometh, at even, or at midnight, or at the cock crowing, or in the morning. You know, I love this verse for its history. There's history in this verse, because before we had watches, before we had wrist watches and we had time, there were night watches. People had watches in the night, and there were four of them, and there were three-hour watches. And the outline of the watches are right here in verse 35. The first watch was at even. The second watch, midnight. The third watch was cock crowing, and then there was morning. And they were broken down in four segments. And so the even was like, I wrote this down somewhere in my notes. It was like, even was 6 o'clock to 9 o'clock. And then the midnight watch was 9 to 12. And then the cock crowing was 12 to 3. And then the morning was 3 to 6. Those were the watches in the night when they had set up watches. And why that's interesting is because whenever we hear that Jesus went walking on the water, and that's when Peter walked on the water with him, it was in the fourth watch of the night. So it tells us what time it was when Jesus was out walking on the water. He was there from 3 to 6. 3 a.m. Who walks on the water? Oh, wait a minute. Who walks on the water, period? right? Jesus not walking on the water at 3 in the morning or sometime in 3 to 6. And that's when he said, when Peter said, hey, Jesus, now you bid me to come. He said, well, come on out here. So Jesus and Peter walked in the water from 3 a.m. to 6 in the morning, sometime in there. And I love this passage because it tells us what the watches are. And there's a responsibility that comes with being a watchman, being a porter. We have to be, and one of the responsibilities, we have to be ready to open the door when the Lord comes. Are you at the door watching? And are you ready for when he comes? Are you ready to open the door and go with him? We can't allow ourselves to be distracted. And if ever we lived in a crazy time, it's a time of distraction. We got television, we got tablets, we got phones. I think it's interesting in this time that we live in that the enemy has brought in so many distractions that people are watching. They are. People are watching, but they're not watching the gates of the temple. They're watching their devices. I'm watching my device. Let me tell you what I'm not going to do, Susan. I'm not going to let it. I'm going to let it be my idol. See, that's the difference. The scripture tells us to keep ourselves from idols. Well, what is an idol? Anything you devote yourself to. Anything you devote your time to. Anything that you spend an inordinate amount of time doing, and you don't do that at any other time. How much time you spend with your device? You know, most of us, if we just dig a little bit inside there, I've never looked at it before, but there's actually a tracker inside most phones that'll tell you how much screen time you've used. But tell me how much time you've been on that device. I think it's very important as Christians to be alert, to use our devices as tools for whatever we might need them for, but not as entertainment. Entertainment is what locks us in and causes us to be devoted. We don't need to be devoted to devices. We need to be devoted to watching the door of our temple because we don't know when the Lord's going to come back. And so there's a responsibility to watch the door and not be distracted by our devices. Devices, door, device. We can't be distracted by devices. We cannot be caught up in idolatry. We have to be watching for our Lord. You know, if we're distracted on the job, it's the same as sleeping on the job. The Lord said, be careful when he comes back, when he doesn't find you sleeping. Don't be sleeping on the job. Finally, there's a reward that comes as a result of watching. See, there's a blessing, there's a responsibility, but finally, there's a reward. You say, what kind of reward comes from watching? Well, it's not just the reward of getting to go with our Lord when he comes to get us. There's another one. Everyone's offering a reward. You can't go to any store or corporate store and buy something where they're not trying to get you to sign up for some kind of rewards. You have rewards, remember? You got Casey's rewards. You got Nichols rewards. Rewards. I find that after about this, ninth or tenth card that I filled out, I said, you know what? I don't want any more reward. The only reward I want is for the Lord to say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. You can keep your rewards. I don't care that I'm going to save a dime on a $1,000 purchase. I don't care. Everyone's offering a reward. But there's a reward that comes from watching. Look with me in the book of Matthew, chapter 26. Before Jesus was about to go embark on his most important journey to the cross, he met with his disciples in the garden. And he asked some of his disciples to go with him. And that while he was going to go a little further, he asked them to watch and pray. He asked them to pray with him because he was about to enter into that time of his betrayal and his subsequent crucifixion and his passion. And let's just read there, 26 verse 40. And he cometh unto his disciples and findeth them asleep. And he saith unto Peter, what? Could you not watch with me 1 hour? Look what he says to them. Watch and pray. Watch and pray. Why? That ye enter not into temptation. See, there's a reward. I don't know about you, but I don't want to go into temptation. In fact, the Lord's Prayer even says, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. That should be the prayer of our heart. I don't want to go into temptation. I know what happens to me. I am a sheep. I'm very well aware of who I am to the Lord. And I'm easily tempted. I'm easily distracted. The reward that comes from watching and praying, Jesus tells us right here. He says, watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. If you like to avoid temptation, the tempter snare. You know that song, Sweet Hour of Prayer, that's in that line is in there. And oft escape the tempter snare by thy return, sweet hour of prayer. When we watch and we pray, we get the reward, the benefit of avoiding the tempter snare. Hey, I like that reward. Why? Because it's eternal dividends. It's not saving a buck on $1,000 purchase. It's being able to be led away from the tempter snare. And Jesus told his disciples right there when he was in the garden, watch and pray that ye enter not into temptation. And in this hour, this new year that we have coming up, let me tell you, I'm not an Nostradamus, but I can see what's going on in our world, and I know you can too. This year is our national election. Daryl probably knows a little bit about elections. He has to go through this about every 4 years. Right? And just on a local election, they can get a little crazy, huh? Let me tell you something. We don't even know how crazy it is. This year is going to be a crazy year. There's a national election. Our country's divided. And let me tell you something. The enemy wants to take God out of our country. He wants to remove the presence of God from our country. And if you think the last 8 years have been crazy, we haven't seen anything yet. I think more than ever, it's so important for us as a church and as a people to watch and pray. Watch and pray to not be distracted by our devices, Zeus. We need to watch and pray so that we can avoid the tempter snare. Because this year, I believe, is going to be a very important year for Christians. You know, this time next year, we may not even be legally allowed to meet like this. We don't know. So much can happen in a year. And I tell you, when we're watching and praying, we need to be thanking the Lord that we can freely meet here on a New Year's Eve night instead of being out somewhere partying. We can be here meeting peaceably, singing, praying, fellowshipping with one another, hearing great messages. We can do that legally this year. We don't know if we can do that next year. We need to be watching. We need to be praying. If you have a loved one that doesn't know the Lord yet, if you have a loved one that's struggling beneath the load of sin and guilt, when we pray, we need to pray for them. That the Lord would be merciful to them before it's everlasting too late. Because when the church is gone, it's over. It's just over. I know this is a small crowd. It's just a small handful. And this is probably the faithful. This is us. But there may be somebody here tonight that still has not got everything straight with the Lord. Now would be a good time to do that. We don't know what's going to happen. In fact, we could start praying just before midnight, and guess what? The Lord could come right through the back door. could. He could see us into the new year and right into heaven. Wouldn't that be awesome? Wouldn't that be great? Just get to leave tonight with the Lord. Go see our loved ones we haven't seen in a long time. There was a little lady at our church over at Little Quita. Her name was Aunt Ella. I don't know if y'all ever knew. You may not have ever known Aunt Ella. I think she passed before you were born. I loved Aunt Ella. She was a sweet lady. I look forward to seeing her again. I look forward to seeing some folks. I look forward to seeing my great-grandpa. Only sat on his lap a few times, but our family is in church tonight because of my great-grandpa. Great-grandpa Morrison. It's because of his faith and his prayers that we're in church. Faith that passed down through him to my father. And to us as children. I want to see my great-grandpa again. I know you guys have folks y'all want to see again too. Wouldn't that be cool if the Lord just come and got us? And we can go home tonight. Let me tell you, it starts with watching. Performing our role as the porter. To watch the gate. To wait daily at his posts. And if you will, that'll be a blessing for you. And Father, we give thanks for the word. We give thanks for this command to watch. It's not a command for a handful. Jesus said there in that last verse, I say to all, watch. And Lord, I have a feeling this is going to be the year to watch. And it could very well be the year that the Lord comes and takes us home. And Lord, I am ready. Some folks I want to see, but more than them, I want to see my Savior. I want to see the face of Him who loved me enough to pull me from the bottom and give me a life and give me a hope. Help us, Lord, to be faithful to watch. Be with us through the remainder of the service in Jesus' name.